Okay, so my name is Jacques Desbiens. I've been in computer-generated hologram for 11 years now. It's my first time at this symposium. I'm very glad to be here. I don't have a scientific background. I come from artistry, and I switched 25 years ago. I switched from artistry to experimentations. I couldn't stand analyzing visual illusions just on theoretical background. I needed to experiment. So I still have difficulties to consider myself as an artist. I see myself as an experimentator. So I want to share with you today some observation on some experiments that I made with what I call just for practical reasons, synthetic holography. I don't want to impose a new way of naming things. It's just that I see a difference between digital holography, analog holography, and making holograms from a limited set of point of views. That's what I call synthetic holography. So I've been involved during between 1998 and 2004, when I left the company, into the development of a holographic imager. It was made in Montreal and in a very close collaboration with Geola in Vilnius. What we wanted to do was simply using 3D computer graphics, making a series of images, point of views, perspective images, and then image an hologram out of it. So we start working on this beautiful machine using Geola lasers and many other components from Geola, and we end up with a machine that is automatic, that is full color RGB with pulse lasers, we were making large format hologram. For us, a large format hologram was of 1 meter 20 large by 1 meter high. And it was made in a few hours. In fact, what was long was not making the hologram, was drying the hologram. So we could print a large format hologram and the next day display it. We develop small pixels, 0.8 millimeter and 1.6, depending on the size of the hologram you want. I left the company in XYZ Imaging in 2004, and then 1 or 2 years later, Rabbit Hole bought the technology. So now it's used by Geola, by Rabbit Hole, and I think a few others in the world. What I was doing was testing. I would make computer images, print them, and then set them up on a wall in front of a CCD camera and a spectrometer, and have this positioning system in, moving X, Y, and Z, and just analyze. So I spent, you know, hours measuring 300 little squares of colors and photographing NTFs and distortion target. Very boring. Things that are helpful when you design and when you develop a machine like this, but for someone who is interested in art, it was very boring. So I got very interested in how this technology will have an impact on the way that you compose image, on the choice that you make when you make the images, and how those choices will have an impact on how people will perceive those holograms. So here's are a few experiments that I did and some observation that I can take out of this. Let's start with the very obvious. There's three zones, three spatial zones in these kind of hologram. In front of the hologram, hologram plane, and behind the hologram plane. So this is very obvious. This is very simple. Nobody really cares about this. unless you start working on the images and you work on a computer, you don't have an hologram, you're not positioning object in real space. You're in virtual space. So after a while, you start becoming very aware of volumes and voids. And voids become so important in one in what you design is that they themselves become volumes. In Occidental art, voids are not really important. We talk about positive space and negative space, and basically voids are emptiness. To find something that I could compare, I had to come into Oriental art, especially Chinese landscape painting, where voids are extremely important, where voids are, in fact, what link space, what is where objects are being born, in fact. It's most of the time considered as a chaotic space, fog, clouds, and it's used in painting to link those space. So I found a painter and scholar of the 11th century, Guo Xi, who is, I guess, very well known by many people here, and in his wonderful little treatise on landscape painting called Lofty Messages of Forest and Streams, he talks about how he represents space in painting in 11th century, if I'm not mistaken, that's the Song Dynasty, I think. Huh? So how he represents space without perspective, but using voids and volumes. And he defined three kind of distance, level distance, deep distance, and high distance. And simply, he divided zones, is a painting by zones, and have voids between them that, like, shift our perception from something close to something far and to something even farther. So I really like this kind of comparison that I could make. So about the same time that I was looking at this, I started, this was in my last hologram at XYZ, so 2004, I started making an hologram as I wanted to make something closer to information display than just making an hologram of an object. So I gathered information about the solar eclipse over Europe in 1999 and make a reconstitution of this event. So what I did is simply having some information about it, having the Earth and the shadow moving over Europe, and when the total eclipse arrived on top of some cities, the city lights up with the name, and it's all synchronized, the hour, the view from Central Europe through a telescope, and the angles of the sun, the moon, and the Earth. So it was simply basically a series of objects that I was making. And then I will talk about this in my other presentation a little bit further, but what I realized with this hologram was that it is really multiple point of view. And this, for me, became, I would say, the central element of how you're making holograms with that kind of technology. Not object in space, but what you're doing is a series of point of view, a sequence of point of views. So I start thinking about synchronizations, in fact. In cinema, you synchronize sound and image over time. You put both at the same level, and then you start your movie. And they follow synchronizing. They follow the synchronization over time. In that kind of hologram, what you do is synchronize over space. Instead of having something that is linked with what you had before and what you will have after, you're synchronizing information between what happens here is synchronized with what happened there. So in this case, for example, the position of the shadow on the Earth is happen at the same time where you have your clock at one given hour, or the view from the telescope. So in fact, there is no time in this. You only have the time of the viewer. Someone at the left will see a moment of the eclipse, and someone at the right will see another moment of the eclipse. So this was a 60 by 80 centimeter hologram on a Slavish plate. Unfortunately, now it's broken. But what is very good with this technology, I still have the computer file, so I printed another. I brought with me a very small version of it, so it's in the exhibition. Then, I started to think about how can I divide this space, and in fact, the viewing space. And I started a new project. I was interested in perspective. I'll talk about it in my other presentation, why. And what I did was another hologram where I simply made a fictitious perspective holography treatise of the 16th century. I wrote a text in Old French, French of the 16th century, describing holography, made 3D illustration. And when you are viewing this image from the left side, you see page 1 and 2. When you move to the right side, you see page 3 and 4. So I realized with this that I could present, in fact, two different content, completely different content, depending on where people are. And someone here will see something different than someone there. So I really like this kind of effect, and I saw this as something that I can't do with anything else unless I have some kind of very complex computer system with positioning sensors and things like that. But still, it will be for one person. In this kind of hologram, many can see the same hologram, but different things. So I continue in that kind of experiment. And recently I did another one using simply numbers. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9. Depending on where you are, you see a different number. So I saw that in this some kind of education purpose, you know. What it means for us is that with that kind of holograms, you can have in the same hologram different content depending on point of view. I can see with this an information display, you could make an hologram with five clients having completely different images. You still have just one hologram, but you have different viewing zones. So I think that that kind of divisions can have a lot of potential, not only in art holography, but also in scientific visualization and in information display. So another thing that I realize with this is how much we have, how many levels of information we can get with this. I was asked to do a simulation, an explanation, a description on how hurricanes are built in nature. So what we did, I did this one in collaboration with Eric Slide, who was a colleague of me in XYZ. And what we did is just, you know, a hurricane, how it turns, how it builds, what, and all sorts of information about size and temperature and movement and all that. We are in Canada, so it's a bilingual country, French and English. We always have the same problem of making information display with two languages. So in this one, depending on where you are, you see French and English, French and English, it's all the same hologram, but language switch when you move. It's translated between different zone of different viewing zone. And I think it points out a very interesting characteristic of that kind of holography. which I call spatial interactivity. Image will change, image will change depending on where you are. So I start looking at this a little bit more. One element, one component that I can see as an effect in that kind of imaging process is what I call directional elements. This is something that people who come from computer graphics and don't know holography, when they try that kind of technology, they don't realize that they can target something with the position of the virtual camera, meaning that somebody somewhere will see this object at that angle. So for example, if you do a computer character, a cartoon character or something like that, you can link the eyes of this character with the position of the camera, meaning that someone moving in the front of the of this hologram, the eyes of the character will always follow this person. So you can build some dramatic effect with this. You can have a gun pointing, arrows, different kind of orientation elements that you can direct depending on the position of the viewer. Someone in front of this will say, hey, this character is looking at me. And someone a little farther will say, no, he's looking at me. Because they see two different moments. So I see directional elements as something that could have interesting applications in information display, such as sign holograms. For example, if you think about the usual you are here maps, you know, those maps where you have your position and then people have difficulties to transfer the information from a 2D map to a 3D environment. Since you can point out direction, if the designer of this hologram know where the hologram would be displayed and what will be the orientation, then you could make a 3D map with elements that would really point the right direction in this three-dimensional space. So you are here, you want to go there, you will have an arrow pointing really in that direction. So I think that there is still a lot of experimentation and investigation in that kind of interactivity that we can foresee. Another thing is, I talk about it a little bit, simultaneity. The fact that people will see different things at different moments. What I noticed, for example, in the Eclipse hologram, is one of my colleague was coming from France, another one from Romania. So they were always positioned at the same space, same angle from the hologram. So I asked them, why are you always look at the hologram from that position and that position? And Jean-Charles said, well, I was in Reims when the eclipse happened, so I saw it from this, so I take this angle. And Bogdan studied in Timișoara, so he was always at this angle. So people will relate with something that for them means something and position themselves, make choices. So in fact, what you're giving with that kind of technology is freedom of observation. People will make choices on how they perceive and how they observe these kind of images. Going further in this direction, I noticed something that a lot of people see as either a defect or something that you don't really consider. It's reversibility. The fact that when you make an animation, you will see, let's say you move from left to right, you see a car moving. Then you move from right to left, well, the car will go backwards. Sometimes it's not really a problem. Most of the time, people will simply accept that there is an orientation. But if you make birds, for example, flying, well, unless it's a hummingbird, birds are not going backwards. So you will have like time inconsistency, time incoherence, things that are different from the realism sometimes that you will look for. Most of the time, it's not a problem. Imagine that you have a client who sells noodles. He wants an hologram with a little girl eating noodles. Great from left to right. Same hologram, the girl is spitting noodles. So, meaning just reverse. Your client won't be happy about this. So, you can't force people unless you put them on automatic carpet or something like that. Look at any exhibition. People are completely chaotic in the way they look at the exhibit. Same thing with holography. You have people arriving from left, from right, from the middle, and they go that way, they go that way, and suddenly they stop and they do. Okay, so you have behavior like that you have absolutely no control. Again, that's because you gave freedom of observation to the viewer. So the next thing is something that I found very, very, very interesting. And most people see time smear, distortion related to animation in holography, as a defect. I would say that scientists want to get rid of it, and artists want to play with it. Usually in documentation, time smear is all mathematics and how you can correct it. So what I wanted to do next was, it was an old test that I did in 2003, and I did it again just a few weeks ago to bring an hologram here because my test was again on glass plate. I didn't want to break it like the other one. So I did a new version of the test, and you have a little video of this hologram. It's not on display in the exhibition, but I have it with me if you are interested. So I simply wanted to visualize time smear and different visual effects that are caused by the same time smear. So in this one, you have a cube with moving vertex and different little element in movement. You can see that for colors are supposed to switch instantly. In fact, you have a wipe. The horizontal line in the box, when they move, they tilt. The cube is completely distorted. You have little balls moving. If a ball moves toward you, and when it changes to behind the plane and in front of the plane, it curves. A ball that goes down or up vertically will stretch and blur because you see one moment with one eye, one moment with the other eyes, and the stereoscopic image don't match enough anymore. So you have many pixels, so you have a stretch. A ball moving horizontally will change its position, apparently, change its position in depth because the distance between left and right image change in relation with the movement of the ball, the orientation of the ball, and the movement of the observer. So you have all sorts of distortions with this, which... Okay, good. I'm almost finished. So position and movement of the observer, the freedom that you gave is so important that even those distortions would change with distance of viewing. So when the viewer moves from away from the distance of the camera, the optimal viewing distance, and in front of that distance, then the tilt of the line change. So I think that, in fact, in art holography, there's a lot of experimentation to do with that kind of effect. And we don't know much about it because what we've been trying to do for many years is correct time smear. But I think that there is something to do with this. So To conclude this presentation, I just want to point out that for many of us, we try to do mimesis with holography. I mean by that, mimesis is showing things. It's imitation. We usually try to make, well, not all of us, but many, and especially in the research and development community, we try to do images that look like real object. We try to mimic object. But these kind of effect that I'm showing you, I think, shows something else, that we have diegesis, which is different from images. It's telling stories. It's how you present information with a sequence, with transformations. And I think that that kind of technology is very different from cinema, because time doesn't exist in it. You only have the time of the observer. There's no speed in these animation. You only have the speed of the movement of the observer. So it's not cinema. It's non-cinematographic. In fact, it's closer to chronophotography than cinema. It's very different. Digital cinema may move to holographic cinema, but hard copy, computer-generated holograms, I think, are different medium with different potential and different effects. Still holography, there's no doubt about it, but a different medium. And in fact, what you realize is when you do these things, you give space. Space is done, but time is undone. Time is completely dismantled. So that's it for now. Thank you.